In the previous video, we learned what are identities, mappings, and trusts, and how are they used to configure PI data archive security in a way that allows us to control who or what really gets access and to tailor the permissions in the most manageable way. In this video, we'll be taking a deep dive into this map to discover exactly what are those security areas on the data archive, and what security defaults are already in place in new PI systems, and should they be leveraged? You might have also heard about PI users and groups and be wondering, how do they fit into this map? So we'll look at that. And finally, we'll also look at why specifically we use trusts for PI interfaces instead of mappings, and are there any other times when we should use PI trusts? To start off with, let's define the different security areas on the data archive. What are those? On the data archive, there's something called the database security table. And this table is divided into different areas that correspond to groups of related tasks. For example, one of them is PI backup. And PI backup, as the name implies, really deals with the permissions for who can see the results of previous backups or perform backups of the PI data archive. There's another area, PIPOINT, and PIPOINT controls top-level access to PIPOINTs. And again, this database security table is not just divided into these two areas, but many other areas. But I want to really focus your attention and talk more about PIPOINT, and that's because it's so important to any user. For any user to see data for even one PIPOINT, you might have also heard the term PI tag used for PIPOINT, they're the same thing, they're going to need some permissions on PIPOINT. And when we talk about the permissions, those permissions are divided into different actions. For example, you could have read permissions, you could have write permissions, you could have no permissions. And remember that the PI identities themselves are the ones that get assigned read, write, or no permissions on these different areas of the database security table. Let's take PIPOINT for example. Maybe our process leads need to be able to create new PIPOINTs, and therefore they would need read-write access on PIPOINT. When we talk about read, that's the same as being able to see something. Now, I had mentioned when I explained that PIPOINT corresponds to controlling top-level access to PIPOINTs. If any of the areas involves top-level access, that means that there are additional permissions of security on a lower level as well. And in the case of PIPOINT, those individual security access permissions are set on each individual PIPOINT as well. On each PIPOINT, there is obviously the settings for the PIPOINT, and there's the data for the PIPOINT. And security can be configured separately on both of these. The ability to see or edit the configuration, as well as the ability to see or edit the data itself. And just like with the database security table areas, the PI identities get assigned the permissions on this level as well. Now we've discovered what those areas are. There's the database security table, and that is divided into different areas like PI backup and PIPOINT, and the PI identities get assigned read, write, or no access on these different areas, and that dictates what they're authorized to do. In addition to the database security table, which covers high-level access in certain areas. There may be settings on individual objects as well. Like in the case of PIPOINTs, there's individual security access that's set up for both configuration and data. Since the PI identities are the ones that are getting assigned these permissions, let's now focus on the default PI identities and what permissions they may or may not have predefined on new systems. In the previous video, I mentioned that one of the default PI identities was PI supervisors, but that there were other default PI identities. We also have PI operators, PI engineers, and PI world. And I want to focus your attention on PI world because this default PI identity has read access to many of the database security table areas by default. And PIWorld, what is PIWorld about? PIWorld represents the concept of everyone. It basically means that all authenticated users on the PI data archive automatically get the access permissions defined for PIWorld, in addition to any other access permissions that they may have been granted. And you can disable the PIWorld identity, and doing so improves your control over the access to the PI data archive, because when PIWorld is disabled, all the users only get the access that's specifically configured for them, and no more. For example, let's say that we have all company, that each employee at our company uses the PI system, but maybe we have some external consultants, and we want to make sure to very specifically tailor the permissions that these external consultants have. The easiest way for us to do this would be to create custom PI identities that match up exactly to the user groups that we have in our organization. So for example, say that we have process engineers, process leads, all of our employees as well, and these external consultants. We can create corresponding PI identities for process engineers, process leads, all company consultants, and we can disable the default PIWorld identity. Now, disabling PIWorld is not something that you should do lightly. In a new system, you should certainly consider disabling PIWorld because you don't have any pre-existing connections or users or applications that are relying on PIWorld access. However, in an existing system, disabling PIWorld could unintentionally lock down areas of access, which would be dangerous, and it can be tricky to determine which users or applications might be relying on PIWorld access. So in these situations, it is absolutely important to make sure that you have moved all of your users or applications away from using PIWorld before you disable it. And for more details, definitely consult the documentation. In addition to customizing your PI identities to match your users and applications, remember, like we saw earlier, we need to be able to link our users or user groups to their specific PI identities. And we do this with PI mappings that match up our Active Directory users and groups to the corresponding PI identities. Remember also that if we can leverage our Active Directory groups, then we'll only need to create 4 mappings, one for each group, versus creating mappings for all the users within these groups. You may have noticed that we haven't specified a PI identity that matches up with our PI system administrator. Now, we could have done this. However, there's actually an existing item on the system that we can use to easily grant all the access for our PI system administrator. Before PI Identities were introduced on the Data Archive with version 3.4.3.80.36, there was something that was used instead called PI Users and PI Groups. Now, PI Users and PI Groups still exist on the Data Archive to support backwards compatibility. And there are some default PI Users and PI Groups that exist even in new systems. And one of these PI groups, specifically piadmins with an S, can be a quick way to get your PI system administrator set up with all the access they need. The reason why this is the case is because on new Data Archive installations, piadmins by default is given read-write access to all the areas in the database security table, as well as the other permissions. So by default, piadmins has write access to absolutely everything on the Data Archive. Now, if someone is truly a PI system administrator, that's exactly what they need, because a PI system administrator needs to be able to do everything on the Data Archive. And because there's not any type of customization that we would necessarily be doing, linking our PI system administrator to the default PI admins group is a really quick way to set them up with the permissions needed. And just like the PI identities, we can also create mappings to the PI groups. So we can map our PI system administrator to PI admins with an S. And the reason why I keep emphasizing the S is because there's actually a PI user instead, that's piadmin, no S. However, we do not want to map any of our users to piadmin. Piadmin is designed to be used only in the case of recovering from a lockout on the system, and it's not something that we need to assign any user on our data archive. So we're going to say no to piadmin, and yes to piadmins only. And the other defaults, we don't need to use them. Now that we have a plan for mapping all of our user groups to piidentities, what about our applications? Now, in the previous video, we discussed that we would be creating PyTrust for our PI interfaces. Let's explore why we specifically need to do this. In this example, you can see that PI interfaces is not the only application I have. I also have PI Coresight. And you'll notice that while we have identities for PI Coresight and PI interfaces, PI Coresight I have set up to use a mapping, and PI interfaces I have set up to use a trust. Now, why is PI Coresight using a mapping and interfaces using trusts? It's all based on the protocol that the application uses to connect to the data archive. Our PI interfaces use the PI API protocol to connect to the data archive. And because they are using the PI API, they have to use PI trusts. PI mappings will not work. And that means that any applications that you may have in addition to PI interfaces that use the PI API to connect to the data archive are also going to need to use PI trusts. However, any applications that you have that use the PI SDK or AF SDK, the newer protocols to connect to the data archive, are going to be able to use mappings. PI Coresight fits this, and so we can use a mapping for PI Coresight where we just link the account that PI Coresight runs under to the PI Coresight identity. PI Coresight is not the only PI application that can use mappings. Another example is PI Buffer Subsystem. PI Buffer Subsystem is typically used with PI interfaces to buffer the data, and the newer versions of PI Buffer Subsystem connect in a way that supports mappings. So we can use mappings for that as well. So when determining for an application whether a mapping or trust can be used, just use trust only for your PI API applications and use mappings for your applications that connect with the PI or AF SDK. In summary, when we talk about PI data archive security, it's all about customizing our PI identities to match up to the users and applications at our organization. Remember, these PI identities need to be assigned permissions on the database security table and other areas, and those permissions could be read, write, or no permissions at all. When it comes to users and groups, we learn that those are the predecessors to PI identities. And in our new system, piadmins could be a nice, easy choice for our PI system administrator, but we're going to avoid using the other ones. And finally, when it comes to knowing whether or not that you should use a trust, remember those are only for the PI API applications, and in general, that means PI interfaces. Our other applications that use the PI or AF SDK can use PI mappings. And whenever possible, we want to use PI mappings because they are the most secure authentication method. Now that we understand the concepts of PI server security, specifically for the data archive, let's get started configuring that in our PI system in the next videos.